I want to finish up by talking again about the media's characterization of the Tea Party and how easy it is for people to play the Nazi card when it comes to their criticism of the Tea Party. This is basically, you know, how the left operates. You have this double standard. I mean, there's no way a right-wing organization could make such a comparison. But the liberals find it very easy to play the Nazi card, even though the Nazis were socialist. It's a national socialist policy. And if you just showed a typical liberal all of the tenets of fascism, if you took a look at Mussolini's fascism, if you took a look at the economic policies that were advocated by the national socialists in both Italy and Germany, you would find nothing that today's liberal Democrats would disagree with. They would want to pass the entire agenda, hook, line, and sinker. So they have a lot in common with the Nazis, other than, you know, and it's not a small thing, was the anti-Semitism and the Holocaust and the murdering of so many people. I don't claim that Democrats would be in favor of that. But if you just look at the economic policies of the Nazis, and more focusing on, let's say, on Mussolini rather than Adolf Hitler, if you just look at the fascism in Italy, that's, you know, they would sign onto it, you know, hook, line, and sinker. But have a listen. This is from Bill Maher on HBO. And Max Brooks, the son of Mel Brooks, one of the great comedic producers, done some of my favorite films, Blazing Saddles, Young Frankenstein, very, you know, funny guy. His son is not quite so funny. But here he is talking about the Tea Party and making the Nazi comparison. Cut number 24.
Well, this has happened before in history. In Germany in the 20s and 30s, there was this right-wing reactionary element that was so terrified of anarchy and communism that they said, you know what, there's a group of street thugs that are real ideologues, and they're willing to take it, and they're willing to bloody themselves. And, you know, once they get into power, we can control them. And that was why they backed them. We can control this. And what they didn't realize...
Is that a stretch? Nazis versus the Tea Party who just want smaller government?
What is true is that ideologues are only loyal to ideology.
So, in other words, an ideologue is an ideologue. So if you believe in something, if you have a principle that you believe in, well, you're just a Nazi because they had a principle that they believed in. They were passionate about their beliefs. So what you actually believe in is immaterial. It's just your passion. If you're passionate about something, well, then you're a Nazi because the Nazis were passionate about what they believed in. Here's the last cut, 25.
And also, I don't know. I mean,
the Tea Party's ideology isn't to take over Europe. It's for smaller government and less.
But they are still ideologues. They don't want to compromise. He used reach
across
the aisle.
You could call Elizabeth Warren an ideologue. Both sides have ideologues.
When you don't compromise, you're an ideologue.
What's that?
When you don't compromise, when you don't reach across the aisle, when you don't participate in the democratic process,
one could argue the opposite. One could argue that's having a strong belief system. And, you know, Obama's on TV all the time saying, well, I'm not going to compromise with Congress. I'm just going to do it myself. And why is that a good thing?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say. Obama doesn't want to compromise my way or the highway. He's an ideologue. Does that make him a Nazi? I mean, but you can throw these comparisons out on the left and no one's going to come back. But somebody on the right tries to do something like that, they would rightfully jump all over him. But it is a double standard. And first of all, look, if you believe in liberty, if you believe in freedom, why would you want to compromise freedom, compromise liberty? Sometimes you have to stand on principle. Sometimes compromise is the wrong thing. We have compromised our way into this economic crisis. We've compromised our way out of the rights that were secured to us by the founding fathers in the Constitution. Compromise has not worked well for Americans. It has not served Americans well. We would have been better if we stuck to our ideological roots, if we stuck to our principles and didn't compromise at all. We'd be a much better country, a much more prosperous country.